Hey, my friends, a new camera, the GoPro Hero 10 Black, and with that, a new video, how to best set up your GoPro for filmmaking. If you like this video, help with feeding that pesky algorithm, like it, share it, comment on it, and with that, you know we don't mess around on this channel, let's jump right into the video. So the very first time you turn on your GoPro, you may have to go through the initial setup, choosing your language, turning on GPS, updating the firmware. I'm not demonstrating this here today. This is how we set up our GoPro for filmmaking after you've done your initial setup. The interface hasn't really changed as much. In the upper left corner, you can see how much recording time is still left on your SD card. In the upper right corner, you can see the battery status, and in the middle, the shooting mode, which you can switch by swiping left and right, and you can go from photo mode to video mode to time-lapse mode. Today, we're having a look as to how to set up your GoPro for filmmaking, hence we stay in video mode. Additionally, we have four shortcuts on the display, two left and two right, which give you easy access to your most used features or functions. If you want to change those, I'll show you how to do this later in the video. And in between, we have also shortcuts to different shooting profiles, so you don't have to adjust a bunch of different settings depending on what it is that you want to shoot. You can switch between standard, activity, cinematic, so on and so forth. Today, we want to set up our GoPro for how we want to shoot video most of the time, hence we adjust the standard profile. So let's start at the top and first of all, have a look at the resolution and the different frame rates that are available to us. In the upper row, you can choose your resolution and you can switch between 1080 all the way up to 5.3K. And you can also switch between the aspect ratio 16:9, which is the standard, to 4:3. 4:3 is great if you're creating content for social media, for an Instagram or Facebook feed, for instance. We are creating here content for YouTube, so we stick with the standard 16:9. In the lower row, we can choose our frame rate or how many images per second we want the GoPro to capture. And we can go all the way down to 24 frames per second, which gives you a cinematic look, all the way up to 240 frames per second, which is what you want to choose if you want to do slow motion. So while there is no right or wrong here, one thing to always keep in mind is that we can only capture a certain amount of video data per second. So if you're choosing a higher resolution than you actually need, or you're capturing more frames than you actually need, you have to divide your video data per second across too many pixels or frames, which unnecessarily can diminish your video quality, which could make a difference, especially if you want to do a bit of post-production work with the video data that you have. So my recommendation is to only choose the resolution and the frame rate that you actually need. Now, I shoot in 4K and 16:9 almost all the time. Very few occasions where I shoot in 2.7K. And then when it comes to frame rates, I go with 60 frames per second when I expect a lot of movement in my shots for outdoor activities, for example. But otherwise, I really prefer that cinematic look. And again, I want to have as much image data as possible per frame. So I go with 4K and 24 frames per second most of the time. So next, let's have a look at the lens or the different fields of views that we can choose from. And there are a bunch of different options available to us, so let's jump right into it. Super view is the widest field of view. It really captures most of what's going on in front of the camera. So if you're doing action sports or you have a helmet or head mount and you're going for that POV perspective, it's really recommended. But it also introduces a very strong fisheye effect or barrel distortion, which in my opinion for everyday shots is really distracting. So unless you're doing POV shots or you do any type of action sports, I wouldn't necessarily recommend this as the default field of view. Next is wide, which is the default or standard field of view for GoPro. So if you're watching a lot of GoPro videos and you like that look, most of them are shot in wide. I personally feel the fisheye effect that is still there is too distracting, but again, if you're after that typical GoPro look, wide would be my recommendation. In linear mode, the GoPro applies software correction for that fisheye effect or barrel distortion, which makes for a more natural look. It's a little bit more cropped in, but if you're doing vlogs or the typical home videos, that would be my recommendation. The video looks more natural, and in the long run, possibly, it's the more pleasing video. Additionally to linear mode, there's also linear mode with horizon leveling, which is awesome. So if you're in run and gun type situations while vlogging, or you want to have that additional level of stabilization in your shot, horizon leveling is the way to go. And in my opinion, the best field of view to choose. Narrow is more cropped in or zoomed in, and there's no fisheye effect either. So if you want to be a little bit more closer to the subject, narrow is the way to go. But again, it's not necessarily something that I choose every day, only occasionally if I really need to. So for me personally, it's really linear with horizon leveling. So experiment with the different fields of views. Remember, there's no right or wrong, and pick the one that gets you closest to the look that you're after for your videos. Next, let's have a look at HyperSmooth, which is image stabilization for your GoPro Hero 10 Black, and it works great. So by default, it is set to high, which gives you the maximum image stabilization possible. Boost smooths out the image even more, but therefore there's a bit of a crop in. If you really need this, you can experiment with this. Otherwise, there is standard. It's less image stabilization, but therefore you can preserve a bit more battery life if that's what you're after. And you can also turn it off, which is good if your GoPro is on a tripod and you really don't need image stabilization. For me personally, it's on high 100% of the time, and it's what I can only recommend here. Scheduled capture is for when you want to tell your GoPro when to start recording video. Great if you're too lazy to get up in the morning to shoot a sunrise, for instance. I never really use this feature, so let's skip over this for now. With duration, you can limit the length of the videos the GoPro shoots. 15 seconds, 30 seconds, 1 minute, which might be handy if you're shooting particularly for Instagram or Facebook stories or TikTok. I personally never really use this feature, so let's skip over this as well. Hindsight is a feature that was developed for you to never really miss a shot, which makes the GoPro add 15 or 30 seconds to the beginning of the video prior to when you press the shutter button, which is great if the situation is unpredictable, hence you're shooting video of your kids or the dog, for instance. But it also means that the GoPro is continuously shooting video, which is very hard on battery life. I prefer battery life and I really don't need this feature, so usually I turn this off. Timer is the typical delay that the camera starts recording with after you press the shutter button. Handy if you still need to jump in front of your camera or organize your shot. Nothing that I really would use on an everyday basis, so let's ignore this. And then also zoom, that you only want to use on occasion when you really need it, so not necessarily a setting that I would adjust here in my main settings window. So let's have a look at ProTune, the advanced settings of our GoPro, which allow us to even further tweak the image. And first of all, let's have a look at bitrate. Remember when I said earlier that we can only capture and save a certain amount of video data per second? That is bitrate. So you can either go with standard, that keeps the file size small, but you don't capture as much video data as you could, or you go with high, bigger file size, but therefore you can capture the most video data that you can, which is great, especially for post-production work, when you want to grade your footage, for example. So I always go with high. Shutter or shutter speed determines how long the shutter stays open for each frame or image we capture. And rule of thumb is twice the frame rate. So when we are shooting in 24 frames per second, if we want to be precise about it, the shutter speed should be 48. Otherwise, we leave the GoPro to automatically adjust the shutter speed, which gives the camera a bit of wiggle room to adjust for your lighting condition and make sure that your shot is exposed properly. I really don't mind this when shooting with the GoPro, so I usually keep this at auto. EV or exposure value compensation allows you to adjust the brightness of your image or video, which is especially handy when shooting in harsh lighting conditions and the highlights are either a little bit too bright or the shadows are a little bit too dark. I personally feel that the GoPro tends to overexpose shots, hence to clip highlights, so I usually keep this at minus 0.5 and make further adjustments only if I really need to. White balance is super important, so let's spend a little bit more time here. So with white balance, you can adjust the color tone of your photos or video, which essentially has a huge impact on the overall look of your video. And while you can keep the white balance at auto and let the GoPro decide what white balance to choose for what lighting and shooting scenario, I highly recommend to set the white balance manually, because that gives you most control over the final look of your video. So at night or indoors, you can cool the image down to 2300 Kelvin. If you want to warm it up during sunsets and sunrises or when it's overcast, you can go all the way up to 6500 or 6000 Kelvin. The typical daylight shot is shot in 5500 Kelvin. If you're really good when it comes to color grading and you know what you're doing in post-production, you can also shoot in native. Native is only a minimally color-corrected sensor readout that gives you most flexibility in post. But getting a color grade right takes a lot of practice and a lot of know-how. So if you're not really used to color grade your own footage, I would manually set the white balance to your liking so the image looks as close to what your final video should look like. Otherwise, if you're not particular when it comes to white balance and you want to have a much easier workflow, just keep it at auto. Now let's talk about ISO. Now ISO determines the sensitivity of the sensor to light. The higher the ISO, the more sensitive the sensor, which means it's better for low light conditions. The camera can capture more image information in low light. However, the higher the ISO, also more noise is being added to the image. So setting the ISO is always a balancing act between the low light capabilities of the camera and how much noise you're willing to accept in your footage. I prefer a cleaner to a brighter image, so I keep the minimum ISO always at 100 and set the maximum ISO to a value that I really only need. If you want to avoid flicker or sudden exposure changes, you can lock the ISO by setting the minimum and maximum ISO to the same level. Here, for instance, 100 or 200 or 400, essentially what you really need for your current lighting conditions. If, however, you want to give your GoPro a little bit more wiggle room so it can adjust the exposure to your current or changing lighting conditions, I would set the maximum ISO to 400, maybe 800, but not more than that. 1600 and upwards, in my opinion, the footage gets too noisy and, in my opinion, isn't really usable anymore. Now with sharpness, we can set the level of details that we want to capture in our image. And by default, it is set to medium, which is a pleasant change because prior to the GoPro Hero 10 Black, the default was high. And high, in my opinion, is way too much. There's so much detail in the image, it almost looks unnatural. Low is good if you do a lot of, post-production and you want to add the level of, sharpening to your image at a post-production level, that is fine. But for everyday use here, I just keep it at medium. In my opinion, it's the right level of sharpness to capture. Now with the GoPro Hero 10 Black, we have three color profiles, which is awesome. Now previously we only had GoPro and flat, but now we have also natural. Natural is a more true-to-life color profile, which is perfect if you don't want to do any type of post-production or grading and just take the footage as it is and share it on social media or with family and friends. If you want to go with something that is more vibrant, more closer to the previous GoPro color profile, you can go with vibrant. Very saturated colors and a lot of contrast can look cool, in my opinion. It's a little bit too much. It's not necessarily the look that I'm going for. No, I usually shoot in flat, which is a much more neutral color profile with a longer curve, which means I capture more information in the highlights and in the shadows, which gives me more flexibility in post-production, especially if I want to color grade the footage or apply a LUT, a lookup table, to the footage, which I'm doing almost all the time. Hence, flat is the choice for me. It gives me more flexibility in post and it gives me a more flexible footage to work with. If you don't do this type of post-production work, just go with natural and you should be fine. Now with raw audio, the GoPro creates or records a separate audio track to your video file, which can be either done in low, moderate, or high audio processing. I personally never really understood why one would use a GoPro for this type of audio work. If you're really in need for really good audio quality, get yourself a separate audio recorder for under $100 and you get much, much better audio results. So if you're after really good audio recording for music, for instance, a separate audio recorder is what I recommend. I personally never use this, so I keep this at off. Last but not least, we have wind noise reduction. So either you can keep this setting at auto and let the GoPro decide whether or not to reduce wind noise in your audio recording, or you can set it to on, which means the GoPro would not record in stereo, but therefore reduce wind noise in your audio, or you can set it to off, which means the GoPro would always record in stereo, but therefore not filter out any wind noise in your audio recording. I'm not too particular when it comes to my audio recording in my GoPro footage, so I just keep it at auto. If you have other needs, adjust the setting here accordingly. Let's keep the media mod settings for a separate video when I demonstrate the media mod with the GoPro Hero 10 Black, but remember earlier when we spoke about the shortcuts and that you can change them to your needs, here is exactly where you do that. If, for example, you don't really care too much about the hyper smooth shortcut in the upper right corner and you'd rather swap this out to something that is a little bit more usable to you, there are a bunch of different settings to choose from. You can, for example, go with color and then switch between the three color profiles that I discussed in the earlier part of the video. So before I let you go, let's swipe down the screen real quickly because there's a quick menu there with some settings that might be really helpful for your video shooting. I rarely use voice commands, so usually I turn them off, and the beeps I definitely turn off. I found them super annoying, so they are off almost all the time. Quick capture is a great little feature. It means even though your GoPro is off, once you press the shutter button, it will start recording video immediately, which is a handy feature. It saves some time, so I usually use it. Screen lock locks the screen, thus prevents from accidentally changing settings. It may has its use here and there, but usually I turn this off. Next, we have a new feature, the video performance modes, which are super, super helpful. So first of all, we have the maximum video performance mode that gives you the best image quality possible. Then we have the extended battery mode. Here you compromise on the image quality a little bit, but therefore it extends your battery life. And then we have the tripod mode, which helps for the camera not to overheat that quickly. So depending on your current shooting scenario, you can switch between these modes real quickly, gives you the best possible outcome. Next, we have the front screen options that are actually super important because first of all, you can either turn the front screen off or you can show the status only. Otherwise, by default, it is set to full screen, which in my opinion doesn't really allow for, you know, framing your shot nicely. Therefore, I always go with actual screen. You can see the final outcome and therefore makes, you know, the composition and the framing much, much easier. And then finally, orientation lock. The GoPro automatically rotates between landscape and portrait mode. If you don't want to have that and lock that orientation, here you can do that. So my friends, this is it. This is how to best set up your GoPro Hero 10 Black for filmmaking, and I hope this video was helpful. If it was, give it a thumbs up because it helps me and helps the channel grow. If you have any questions, anything that I haven't addressed in today's video, leave a comment down below and I'll get back to you. And most importantly, if you want to see more of this type of content, GoPro related, camera related, photography, videography, subscribe to this channel and hit that bell icon so you get notified when I'm uploading new videos. And with that, as always, I'll catch you guys in my next video.